Okay, good evening everybody. Great to see you all here. This is the last of this term's series of conspiracy and democracy open public lectures. Just for anybody who hasn't been to one of these before, the Conspiracy and Democracy Project is a Levy Shulman funded 5-year-long project studying conspiracies, conspiracy theories, and their relationship to democracy. And it's my great pleasure to introduce our speaker, Professor Lawrence Quill, University Head of Department of Political Science and, in San Jose State, who's been with us for the last few weeks, and has been a wonderful intellectual contributor to our project. He's written in the past on secrecy and politics, but as you'll see today, the project that he's currently working on is to do with technology and conspiracy. And so, without further ado, I'll hand you over to Lawrence, who will talk for about 40, 45 minutes, followed by a short comment from me, and then some questions from you. Thanks very much.
Thanks, Alfred. Okay, splendid. Just throw bills. Fine. Now, thank you so much, all of you, for turning up in this glorious November afternoon. It's absolutely freezing here. I can't believe it. Let me just say, before I get going, it's been an absolute pleasure to be at Crash for the past few weeks. All of them are absolutely wonderful, wonderful people, the PIs and the postdocs, and it's just the kind of intellectual environment that you long to find as an academic, so they're absolutely wonderful, and I've loved every moment of it. Now, of course, all of the mistakes that I'm about to make are mine and mine alone and have nothing whatsoever to do with the project. So here we go. I'm going to talk about what I've called technological conspiracies. And in order to set the tone for the rest of the talk, I'm going to show you a brief commercial. So if you'll just bear with me, I'm going to walk over to the other computer and click a button.
This is your house. This is your car. This is your toothbrush. These are your things. But these are the things that matter. And somewhere in between is this guy. Introducing Jibo, the world's first family robot. Say hi, Jibo.
Hi, Jibo.
Jibo helps everyone out throughout their day. He's the world's best cameraman. By intelligently tracking the action around him, he can independently take video and photos so that you can put down your camera and be a part of the scene.
Jibo, take the picture.
He's a hands-free helper. You can talk to him, and he'll talk to you back, so you don't have to skip a beat.
Excuse me, Anne?
Yes, Jibo.
Melissa just sent a reminder that she's picking you up in half an hour to go grocery shopping.
Thanks, Jibo.
He's an entertainer and educator. Through interactive applications, Jibo can teach.
Let me in, or else I'll...
Huh.
And I'll...
Huh.
And I'll blow your house in.
Hey, where'd you go? There you are.
He's the closest thing to a real-life teleportation device. He can turn and look at whoever you want with a simple tap of your finger.
Check out my turkey dinner, Mom.
I wish you wouldn't eat that.
Hey, they make turkey pizza?
I want turkey pizza.
And he's a platform, so his skills keep expanding. He'll be able to connect to your home.
Welcome home, Eric.
Hey, buddy. Can you order some takeout for me?
Sure thing. Chinese, as usual?
You know me so well.
And even be a great wingman.
You have a voice message from Ashley. Want to hear it?
Absolutely.
Hey, call me when you're home.
Better make that takeoff for two, Jibo.
We've dreamt of it for years, and now he's finally here. And he's not just an aluminum shell, nor is he just a three-axis motor system. He's not even just a connected device. He's one of the family.
Now, Jibo.
This is not a spoof. This is a real product that's going to go into production probably the end of this year, next year. And it's going to be ready for sale, I think, in something like 28 different countries. If you want to find out more about it, just go to jibo.com, J-I-B-O.com. This is a product that is a spin-off from one of the super amazing labs at MIT. So when I first saw this, a student showed me, I was absolutely terrified. I couldn't understand what I was looking at. But by about the fifth time, I really wanted one. So I'll talk about that in just a little bit. Okay. So I've called the title of my talk Technological Conspiracies, but it's not obvious that these two terms, technology and conspiracy, go together at all. Normally, we think of technology as a good thing. We think of it as something that will liberate us, make us more free. We see technology as a benevolent force in the world, especially internet, networking technologies. All we have to do is think of Facebook or think of Skype, for example. Conspiracies, on the other hand, well, we don't really like the sound of conspiracies at all. A conspiracy is regarded, quite rightly, as a morally questionable practice or activity, something that people do in secret in a smoke-filled room where they're planning some kind of evil takeover. All we have to do is think of those great conspiracies in Bond movies, for example, and we get the general idea. The idea of conspiracy is supposed to be something that's very old-fashioned, something that you find in the literature of ancient Greece or Rome. Perhaps you'd find it in Italy in the 15th century. All we have to do is think of Machiavelli. Yes, okay, now we're really getting the hang of conspiracies. But in modern politics, from about the 17th century onwards, talk of conspiracy doesn't disappear, but people talk about it a lot less. And there's a good reason for that. And it has something to do with technology. It has a great deal to do with how people start to talk about what I'm going to call the technology of government. Because they talk about constitutional government, and they talk about checks and balance, which is, of course, a machine metaphor. So in a certain sense, technology and liberalism go together very well indeed. But there are tensions in this project. For the political theorists amongst us, and even those who are not political theorists, we might think of a very famous political theorist called Thomas Hobbes. And Thomas Hobbes loves machine metaphors. In the opening to his famous book, Leviathan, he talks about the heart being just like a spring, and the nerves of the body just being like strings, and the joints like wheels, giving motion to the whole body. But Thomas Hobbes's theory of government is what we might call very illiberal. It's absolutist. He gives a great deal of power to the government, so much so that individuals within his state can't even turn to their own conscience to question the judgment or activities of Leviathan. Fast forward a couple of hundred years to a thinker like John Stuart Mill, and Mill is very, very critical of machine metaphors like balance. In a famous speech that he gives in 1834, he says that whenever somebody starts talking about balance in politics, what they're really doing is they're masking the real imbalances of power that go on in society. And he doesn't stop there. John Stuart Mill, writing in the 19th century, very concerned with machine metaphors, is also concerned with the rise of bureaucracies and the rise of what he regards as a kind of technological determinism, of the kind that he sees in thinkers like Auguste Comte in France in that same period. Technological determinism being the belief that technology is something we just have to get out of the way of. It's going to revolutionize the world. It's going to change how we do everything, our politics, and, in fact, how we think about ourselves. By the end of the 19th century, more and more opinions start to emerge that something has gone terribly wrong with technology. As American industrial power grows at that time, and Britain's relatively declines, thinkers like Max Nordau, a German novelist, offers a diagnosis for what he thinks is going wrong in Europe. And in his famous book called Degeneration, he identifies the new diseases of technology as the potential culprits. Now, these are not particularly scary diseases. He offers two, railway spine and railway brain. And apparently you can catch those by traveling on trains, all right? But he's not the only person to identify the notion that technology, maybe democracy, maybe are not the best bedfellows. Friedrich Nietzsche complains that there's a lack of quietness and places of silence in modern towns. Now, when I read that recently, I thought, well, I wonder if there's an app today for finding a quiet space in a modern town. Actually, there is an app for that today. It's Breather, if you're interested, Breather. I think there's another one called Headspace. And specifically, these are apps. So if you go to New York, I think there's another one in Montreal, a couple of other places. If you just need 20 minutes to just pull yourself together and get away from it all, you use this app and you can find a place. Obviously, you have to be charged for it. So anyway, that's not the point. Get the general idea. Nietzsche's not alone. Freud, in the early part of the 20th century, writes his book Civilization and Its Discontents. It's a great little book, but in that book, he also points to the shortcomings of technology. He says, really, what is all this technology for? It's being celebrated, but a lot of the technological solutions to things that are being posited aren't really problems in the first place. He says, if there'd been no railway to conquer distances, my child would never have left home, and I should not now need a telephone to hear his voice. Okay, some suspicion then. In the United States, even at the height of industrial achievement during this period, there were other related concerns about technology companies. In Frank Norris's book, written in 1901, called The Octopus, we find a detailed description of the power of these new technology companies. In his case, he's writing about the Pacific Railroad in California. And that company did a great many things, but it also exerted a terrible influence over the environment, local communities, and a thoroughly corrupting influence over the political process. And then there's the camera. The camera. Perhaps more than any other technology during this period, the camera serves as a wake-up call for people who want to protect their privacy, in much the same way that people today see drones and how drone surveillance is kind of infiltrating society as a similar wake-up call. In one of the most celebrated articles defending the right to privacy, long before thinkers like Isaiah Berlin in this country identified a similar threat to individual freedom from technocracy and the goodwill of technocrats, two lawyers, Samuel Warren and Louis Brandeis, who both later served on the Supreme Court as justices, developed a defense of the right to privacy, though no such explicit right existed then under the Constitution or now. They based this right upon what they called the right to be left alone. And they combined with it a particular view of what they understood it meant to be a person. And what that person was the kind of individual that needed a space around them where they could be left alone to do what they wanted to do without interference from anybody, the state or other individuals. Now, it was going to be very, very difficult, they said, to preserve this kind of individuality because of the very great advances in technology and the business methods that were behind them and supporting them. These photographs in particular they identified as invading, quote, the sacred precincts of private and domestic life. And that, they said, is going to cause no end of mental distress to people. It's going to make them very, very unhappy. Much more unhappy than even the threats they might face from real physical bodily injury. They wrote their article in 1890. Today, it is not uncommon for leaders of major technology corporations to speak about the inevitability of a post-private world, for politicians to offer the not very reassuring cliche that you have nothing to fear if you have nothing to hide, and where a novelist, Dave Eggers, writing a book like The Circle, can conjure up an Orwellian line like privacy is theft to describe a very recognisable dystopian vision of the near future. So my question is, what's happening and what's happened? Well, we can probably identify at least a dozen reasons for the loss of privacy and a corresponding decline in individual selfhood, or that kind of understanding of what it means to be a person, identified by the likes of Mill, Warren and Brandeis, and Isaiah Berlin. We could, I suppose, quite easily trace the origins of this decline to a thinker like Darwin, and we could see modern research into our genetic inheritance as the inevitable decline of related ideas like individual will or human freedom. Human beings, for many people, have been reimagined today as mere carriers of DNA. We might lament, additionally, the corruption of language that has taken place as a result of the dominance of certain kinds of thinking, economic rationality, for example, which compels us to see ourselves as consumers, clients, or products that can all be monetized. Or we might, with equal measure, turn to developments in the humanities that seem to delight in suspicion and skepticism, where, to quote one authority, quote, the Western rational self has bitten the dust. But for the rest of the talk, I want to offer a different explanation. And my explanation is technological conspiracy. So, there's a definition I'll leave up for a while. A technological conspiracy refers to a group of individuals possessing a highly developed scientific skill set engaged in activities that advance their interests at society's cost, while simultaneously producing a discourse that deliberately challenges the conventional wisdom or traditional structures of power within that society. As we shall see, we are hardly passive participants in this drama. We embrace the language and ideas of this conspiracy, using them to describe ourselves and our actions, and condemning those who are not sufficiently tech-savvy. In doing so, we participate in what some authors have called a conspiracy against ourselves. One more note about definition before I move on, though. While I think science and scientists have, for the past few years, found themselves on the back foot. One might think of examples like the BSE crisis or Climategate, the predictive power of economics as a science, and the ongoing debate concerning vaccinations. I think technology, and by extension technology companies, have fared much better. By technology, I don't just mean the production of tools and magical gadgets, but also technology is a kind of social doctrine, a new social philosophy. In fact, what we might suggest is this. In the early 21st century, technology is the only coherent and persuasive authority available to people who live in Western secular states, but not just those, actually. Efficiency, technical calculation, the distrust of human judgment, scientific expertise, and the dismissal of anything that can't be measured are the new mantras of this doctrine, and they form a new philosophy of culture. Increasingly, human life must serve these principles because there is no purpose beyond them. Older ways of thinking, be they religious or philosophical, simply lose their purchase on the imagination. They become irrelevant. A world that was once solid now appears temporary. The only thing left is technological progress, which guarantees novelty and a better version of society almost on a weekly basis. As it stands, though, even this description is incomplete because it doesn't explain the devotion that people have to their gadgets, the almost cultish manner in which they work and play, in short, the centrality of belief to this evangelical tech utopianism. As Professor Larry Seedentop of Oxford notes in a recent book about the origins of the individual in the West, belief, and Christian beliefs in particular, laid the foundations for the development of the idea of the individual here. It was St. Paul who developed the notion of natural equality before God, of the need for an individual response to the Creator rather than the strict adherence to social doctrine, along with the idea that the kingdom of God was within each one of us, leading through various quirks of history to the notion of an individual will, a belief in the moral equality of all human beings, and the creation of a public role and a private space for conscience. Secularism, far from being beyond belief, is utterly grounded in Paul's version of Christianity. What I'm suggesting is that this set of beliefs, the Christian origins of liberal individualism that connects so strongly to notions like privacy, are no longer sufficiently persuasive. In the wake of this loss of faith, a different set of beliefs inspired by a different religious tradition is, via technology, updating our image of ourselves and our relationship to society. If there is a text that is the gospel for these new techno-conspiracists, it is not Das Kapital, it is not the interpretation of dreams, it's not even Atlas Shrugged, although, of course, Ayn Rand plays a rather important role in Silicon Valley. It's this. Zen and the Art of Motorcycle Maintenance. Right, perhaps not the reaction I was looking for, but bear with me. By the time of its publication in 1974, writers and artists in California and elsewhere were very familiar with Asia. Japan, in particular, was regarded as an antidote to the West's obsession with machine culture. The argument ran something like this. Since the Enlightenment, the West has become obsessed with dualistic thinking, with mind separated from body, but also from others and from nature. The result has been domination and mastery, mechanistic ideologies of disenchantment. By contrast, the civilization of the East offers a more organic and aesthetic understanding of our place with one another and the cosmos. Now, Persig's book sold millions of copies and was a perfect accompaniment to the late stages of what's called the counterculture movement. He offered a tech-friendly, post-60s perspective that in many ways continued the critique of technology offered by celebrity academics in America like Herbert Marcuse. But whereas the Marxist Marcuse thought that a new era of individual freedom would be ushered in because of an artistic revolution, Marcuse really liked jazz a lot. Others turned away from politics to technology and computers to provide a radically different solution that politics could not. As Theodore Rorschach, who's the professor of history who coined the term counterculture, noted, the view in the early 70s, emerging in places like the Bay Area in California, was a peculiar blend of organic farming, Zen Buddhism, and cybernetics. Technology was seen as a solution to politics and divided opinion. Individuals could outsmart the system of technological illiterates, i.e. politicians, by circumventing political economy and class conflicts altogether. What emerged was a belief that if you pushed the industrial process to its limits, it would generate its own medicine. Out of the advanced research in electronics, there would emerge all kinds of solutions to political and indeed environmental problems. Persig argued for a more holistic approach to technology. He noted in the opening pages of his book that technology, far from being a barrier to human experience, was crucial to it. He said, you see things vacationing on a motorcycle in a way that is completely different from any other. You're in the scene. You're not just watching anymore, and the sense of presence is overwhelming. For Persig, contact with nature via the technology of the motorcycle is everything. And crucially, he extends this feeling of cosmic oneness to the computer. And I'm not going to read that out. You can read that for yourselves. The target for Persig in the book is rationality, the kind of Western thinking that separates the individual from the thing or from anything, in fact. Overcoming these false oppositions is his task in the book so that dualism, the supposed opposition between self, other, and world, can be reunited. In Buddhism, there is not, strictly speaking, a sense of self, an autonomous, separate entity. Instead of a divine creator, the focus is on divine force, which permeates everything, animate or inanimate. There is no duality between mind and matter, but a belief that everything is imbued with spirit. Okay. What technology permits, then, is a fusion of nature and the human spirit into a new kind of creation that transcends both. In fact, what happens in the book is that the more Persig works on his motorcycle, the more he realizes that the machine is simply an extension of himself. Quote, the machine that appears to be out there and the person that appears to be in here are not two separate things. In Japan in the 1920s, and especially after the Second World War, the machine, and the robot in particular, was often cast as hero and savior of mankind, fighting for peace and criticizing humanity for its shortcomings. In short, robots were humanity's conscience because, to quote the title of a very famous book written by a roboticist in Japan, the Buddha is in the robot. By the 1980s, popular culture in the West had started to pursue a similar path, recasting the computer and the robot from the nightmarish HAL of 2001, which came out in 1968, or Demon Seed, which is a computer that takes, anyway, it's a really horrible movie, in 1977, to the empowering tool of the individual. Over the next 30 years, with some notable exceptions, as the political economy and output of the entertainment industry was transformed by the introduction of computers, a new fascination with computers, also coupled with playing computer games, which really took off as well, meant that increasingly robots emerged in a different way. They were cast less as villains and more as our friends. You can track the changes in movies like Star Wars in 1977 with C-3PO and R2-D2. and of course the Zen mastership of Yoda, but I'm not going to dwell on that point. Then there's Short Circuit, comes out in the mid-80s. It's a military robot struck by lightning that becomes a pacifist. Sounds a bit like Martin Luther, but probably not. Then there's Batteries Not Included. These are alien repair robots fixing broken items for elderly people. Sounds really nice. Then there's the Terminator 2, of course, very different from Terminator 1 because Arnold Schwarzenegger's character develops a conscience. Very interesting. Then there's the whole Star Trek, Trekkie thing, with Mr. Data, the android in Star Trek who wrestles with kind of emotions and the contradictions of human beings. AI, Steven Spielberg's really extraordinary movie of 2001, where an android child and teddy bear, and I'll come back to teddy bears later, comfort grieving parents. iRobot, 2004, a murder mystery that's solved by a robot with a conscience and a taste for self-determination. WALL-E, 2008, an ecological robot that cleans up Earth's trash. And finally, Her, in 2013, which won an Oscar for Best Screenplay, the story of a piece of intelligent, sexy-sounding software with whom the protagonist, a lonely divorcee, falls in love. All right. In other words, what happened in Japan from the 1950s onwards, as robots took over popular culture, occurs in California and elsewhere from the 1970s onwards. In the US, and other markets, we can also track the changes in another way. Children that were introduced to computers and robots in the form of toys in the 1970s had the grand ambition, very often, of working out how to kill them. This was the shared fate of high-tech toys like Speak and Spell. With its very robotic voice and irritating American English spelling, it was obviously a machine, and you obviously wanted to kill it if you had one. Simon was another one, a memory game with flashing lights, and that died when you took the batteries out. I can attest to that. In the 1990s, these machines changed their character. The first was the Tamagotchi. The Tamagotchi was a digital handheld pet shaped like an egg that could sit easily in the palm of your hand. Unlike the earlier machines, this one demanded care. A Tamagotchi grew up. It could be fed and tended. In later incarnations, it could even marry and have children. The anthropologist Sherry Turkle observed in her wonderful study of this, called Alone Together, that children stopped wondering about how these machines worked and simply wanted to look after them. Other machines followed that made similar demands. There were Furbies, if you remember Furbies. These could be, in quotes, taught how to talk. Actually, they had a pre-programmed vocabulary of about 600 words that they developed on their own. If you held them upside down, they would scream. Then there was My Real Baby, which looked like an actual baby and whizzed and whirred, also I think developed and spun off from MIT. That came out in 2000. It shut down when it was in distress or when it was spanked. The attitudinal shift that occurred over this period in children was remarkable. Turkle noted that in the 1990s, the teens she spoke to knew the difference straight away between robots and people. Robots never made mistakes. People did, but that frailty is what made you feel close to them. 25 years later, with another group of teens, the conversation is very different. Now the robot for these teens is preferred to the parent, because the robot is reliable and has more time for children than distracted and overworked parents who are always on their phones or computers checking their email. Children, concludes Turkle, seem primed for a world where robots take the place of family members. And not just parents either. There are robot dogs that can be programmed, Sony's Aibo being the most famous. There are robot seals, the Paro seal, which you can look at online, which is used widely in care homes in the US and Europe. It's a big furry seal with big eyes. It's very cute. Robots, in short then, fill a social need. They are a solution to a new kind of problem. But they're also much more than that, as we saw with Jibo at the beginning of the talk. There are all sorts of interesting philosophical puzzles at play here concerning whether or not machines can think, whether in fact they can feel, and whether those are the right questions, actually. But philosophy aside, the consequences of all this should be fairly obvious, along with the answer to our initial question, which was, what has happened to our notion of privacy? And the related question, why aren't more people up in arms about this loss? Well, I think that what has happened is that we've moved from one kind of enlightenment thinking to another. And our relationship with things, with technology, is central to this idea. In fact, what the Persig-inspired beliefs, which we might call techno-Zen, provide us with is the ideology that binds lots of competing and often contradictory ideas together about the economy, politics, society, and us. If I'm right here, then there is a technological conspiracy at work, but it's a very unusual one, because it's not exclusively technocratic, because it's also corporate. It is open, it is visible, it's ostensibly democratic, in many forms it is evangelical, it holds out the promise of a better world for those who participate by purchasing products and lifestyles in exchange for dollars and personal data. Technological conspiracy is techno-Zen with a feverish attachment to things. Our notion of privacy, something that always was in tension in liberal democracies, where the state desired to know as much as possible about its citizens, is changing fast, almost as fast as every change that Facebook makes to its privacy policy. As our faith in technology grows, so too does the thickness of the digital curtain. We lose faith in human judgment and subjectivity. We value less the limits of being human and compare ourselves unfavorably with machines that never get tired, never age, and rarely make mistakes. The answers as to how we might cope with these extraordinary challenges that are offered are not very comforting. Usually, education, whatever that means, is identified as being required. Alternatively, we're told that what we need to do is to embrace technology even more, work with machines and not see them as the enemy. And there is always, of course, the economic imperative, the search for excellence, we might say, to quote the title of a legendary business book by the management guru Tom Peters, who, interestingly enough, quotes lengthy passages from Zen and the Art of Motorcycle Maintenance. Because it turns out that techno-Zen is entirely compatible with hyper-productive, absolutely dedicated employees. Much more could be said about the link, then, between neoliberalism and corporate Zen, but let's go back to privacy and why we give it up so readily. I think we give it up for a conspiracy of beautiful things. One need only think of how Stephen Fry, for example, writes about his admiration for the iPhone or Apple in The Guardian or The Daily Telegraph in fairly gushing prose. And of course, we're changing our relationship to these things of beauty. There's little doubt that the next generation is going to be very comfortable with embedded, as they're called, or ambient technologies. And large tech companies know this, which is why they're working on products like Jibo, and why these images were released recently in a BBC story about a Google patent that apparently it's not going to go into production, but this was basically for toys that were networked and could basically, their eyes would follow you around the room. They kind of track you, which is, of course, very useful, I think. There's little doubt that one of the next major growth sectors in consumer electronics is going to be the kind of social robotics epitomised by Jibo and other devices that combine network and cellular technologies with service precision by running apps and by possessing some of the features of caring, reading to children, ordering food, and keeping you company. The fact that what you install in your home for a relatively small amount of money is what a previous generation would have called inviting a spy into your home. But I think that's probably going to be lost on people that see the all too obvious benefits of these truly magical technologies. And this is a big problem. And I think it's a problem that's going to remain invisible for the most part, because technology is not neutral, and neither is code, or numbers for that matter. There are human subjective judgments lurking behind the apparent objectivity offered by numbers, algorithms, and even the operating systems of friendly robots. Ambient or embedded technologies are a form of digital animism. They enchant our environment, support us, and befriend us. And at the same time, they make it incredibly easy for all sorts of organizations to collect information about us, our wants and needs, that make it easy to usher in new forms of surveillance and control. Thank you very much for your patience and your time.
I'll stay over here.
Thank you very much, Lawrence. That was a fantastic, stimulating, creative paper. And I'm just going to make a few short comments, a few questions and comments that I'm going to structure around the three parts of your title, really: technology, conspiracy, and enchantment. So there's a question at the heart of your talk, I think, that I find isn't quite spelled out, right? And it's a sort of basic question, which is, what is political about technology? What exactly is political about technology? So one way, you know, there are a number of ways we could talk about this, right? One is to say perhaps it's because values are embedded in artifacts, you know, like speed bumps, or like the way my TV switched off automatically the other day after I spent 4 hours watching the tennis, judging me, you know. But perhaps it's because technology is political because it redistributes resources and risks. And if politics is a matter of who gets what, when, and how, as the famous old saying has it, then technology, by extension, is going to be political in that sense of resource distribution. And another thought is that technology just shapes the material conditions of our lives. And particularly, as you've suggested here, even our sense of self is going to be mediated and shaped by our technologies. But there's a fourth sort of sense in which we could say something becomes political, and that's a sense that it becomes political when it's subject to conflict, and conflict under pressure for a collective decision. And in this sense, technology, like almost anything else, can potentially be political. And I feel like there are elements of all of these that I can pick out present in your paper, but you certainly seem to find that the problem is that there's not enough conflict. You know, you want to ask, why does nobody care about this looming technological conspiracy? Why isn't there more awareness and resistance? And there are, again, a few different answers. You know? One of them is that we don't mind, that it's consensual. Another is that, you know, so there is no conflict. Another is that, yeah, there is conflict, but it's kind of suppressed or latent. You know, perhaps those who suffer injuries just don't have power, don't have voice, can't resist or articulate it. Or maybe, and this is the most sinister, and I think maybe you subscribe to this one, that they don't recognize themselves as being in a relation of power at all, and that this involves some element of ideology. Again, perhaps one that you maybe have sympathy with. So I was wondering if you could basically, you know, elaborate a little more on, like, you know, what exactly is political about technology here. And my second point is that where you start talking about conspiracy, you're using conspiracy, I feel, in the sense of like a kind of a call to arms, you know, a calling us that there's something here we ought to be worried about. So in that sense, I think you sound like a conspiracy theorist in the best sense of the word. And I want to make a few observations about this technological conspiracy. You admit that it's a rather unusual kind of conspiracy, and I'm going to make two points about it. Conspiracy on this account doesn't involve individual or collective intention. It just involves, as you say, a group of individuals engaged in activities that advance their interests. So you have individuals and their interests, but you don't have any explicit agreement, any of the sort of, you know, so that's one way in which you depart from the sort of classic notion of conspiracy. I'm pretty sympathetic with that. But you also say that it's open, visible, and ostensibly democratic. So here the question is, if it's open and visible, then where's the conspiracy? If it involves a group of individuals trying to advance their interest in an open, in plain sight, where's the conspiracy? And so I was thinking about this, and I was thinking, well, one way in which we could think of this sort of thing as a conspiracy is in terms of what we might call a kind of environmental conception of conspiracy, right? That is, as a set of conditions and that incentivize and encourage conspiracy in the more conventional sense of hidden coordination in a partial interest. So, as you say at the end of your essay, you know, new technologies make it easy to usher in new forms of surveillance and control. So, and it's interesting, if we think then in terms of this like environmental conception of conspiracy, I think it's interesting because it links up to a lot more of the history of conspiracy, but in a different sort of way. Because the classic version of the environmental conception of conspiracy, right, is the kind of account that people like Bernard Bailyn or Gordon Wood give of the revolutionary period, the late 18th century. Right? The politics of the 18th century, they said, was rife with language of corruption and conspiracy, where that meant excessive private interests influencing the exercise of public power. And so, you know, the American founding fathers were obsessed, especially Madison, obsessed with creating institutions that would sort of hedge against private power. And the point is that they saw corruption and conspiracy as structural phenomena, and they saw the solutions as structural as well. It wasn't about picking out particular conspiracies and punishing them, but changing the incentives. Spin forward to a more recent version of the environmental conspiracy. Right-wing thinkers quite recently, over the last 50 years, have attacked democratic politics as a realm in which the incentives encourage hidden coordination by special interests to subvert public interests, to seize public funds, to influence political power. And again, what's environmental here is that it's not sort of about believing particular, you know, in particular bad guys or particular groups or a particular, as a Bond villain, smoky room. But it's about seeing politics as structured in a way that makes such behavior more likely. And so this environmental conception is, has always been sort of directed at government, right? It's always been, and especially democratic politics has been the site of these environmental conceptions of conspiracy. So what's striking about what you do is that you locate this kind of environmental conception, as I'm calling it, in the domain of the market. And that's striking because in recent years, the predominant view is the market is where you don't get the conspiracies. It's an unfavorable environment for conspiracies because it's just the domain where vast numbers of people use their own judgments in taking up goods and services in an uncoordinated, horizontal, voluntaristic sort of network of exchanges. And this environment tends away from conspiracy because the outcomes are the result of nobody's design. So, you know, and that's, so when you were talking about technology, I was thinking about, I was thinking in terms of innovation, creativity, and classic sorts of accounts of what goes on in a market. And so what's striking when you sort of, when you talk about what, you know, a kind of environmental conception of conspiracy and in this domain of technology, and we think, where's the conspiracy? Then I think, you know, there are a few dimensions. One that you sort of hint at is a kind of second-order technocracy, right, at the level of managing and owning the structures within which we all go about our business. But then there's the threat of values, judgments being embedded within the sort of black box of technology, as it were. And then there's something you didn't mention so much, but which is probably there in the background as well, but the threat of monopoly. But anyway, I'm not sure if that environmental conspiracy is quite what you have in mind, so the question there is it? And then my third point then was about disenchantment and reenchantment. And your story here is on the one hand about the blending and blurring of man and machine, you know. And then on the other hand, it's about what you call reenchantment, as, you know, robots are recast as companions and so on, in this kind of ideology of techno-zen. But I wonder if we might go back and push the idea of disenchantment a bit further here. So when Max Weber wrote about the disenchantment of the world, he was referring, among other things, to rationalization, by which he meant the displacement of sort of magical elements of thought, right? The idea basically was that the world might be very complicated, but it's not mysterious. You know, there's no mysterious, incalculable force that comes into play, right? We can, in principle, master all things. So putting that together with your thoughts from Robert Persig, you know, we might think, okay, well, to the extent that the self becomes manifest in technological systems, you know, through behavior, through my comments and the likes on friends' activities, through articles I choose to read and the click trail that I leave whenever I go on the internet, robots I interact with, I wonder if the story isn't rather that aspects of the self then, to the extent that they're manifest through technology, become knowable and calculable, and that there's a sort of disenchantment, a potential disenchantment of the self that's possible there. But this, this I should say, to sort of wrap up, is that one of the things I find really interesting, I found a lot, that's only to scratch the surface of the sort of richness of the talk, but I thought it was really interesting that you put privacy in the context of disenchantment. Mm-hmm. They're not mentioned together very often, and perhaps they should be. perhaps one reason they should be, why the language of privacy makes less sense today, is that what's often being revealed about the self and about society comes in the form of aspects of human behavior being made more and more visible and calculable and thus into possible objects of intervention. Intervention by ourselves or intervention by others. So the division is not so much private-public, but sort of knowable-unknowable. So there, to sum up, you know, what is political about technology, what is conspiratorial about the conspiracy, and what about disenchantment? But thank you very much for a really stimulating talk. And I'm going to stand up here because we're going to also take questions from the floor now as well.
Okay, so thank you for that. That was excellent, really, really good, and it's given me a lot to think about. Let's take the easy one first. I think the environmental conception of conspiracy that you talked to is probably what I'm trying to do. I should just say, by way of making excuses for myself, that a really large part of this project, though it's a professional interest, is also a personal interest, because I live in the Bay Area in California. So I live in Silicon Valley, and it's an absolutely wonderful place to live. And I reckon if you haven't been there, you should go. It's absolutely fantastic. But it's very unusual. It's very unusual. Because you do have the kind of tech optimism, the utopias, and a belief. It is really a belief in the wonders of technology and how that's really going to change the world. So your comments are helping me work out what it is that I think, which is kind of why it was so useful to write this sort of paper. In terms of kind of whether or not conspiracy is a call to arms, I'm not sure about that yet, or at least my version of it. In terms of the politics, which is a really, really important question, and what is really political about technological conspiracies and what's political about the talk, I don't think I want to be as rude as to suggest that I think that people don't recognise that they're caught in relation to power. I don't know, perhaps I was just brought up in a certain way that you didn't even never say that to me. That's a dreadful thing to say to me. However, I think that the whole reason I wanted to sort of bring politics back in to a discussion about technology is because very often it's left out. And very often technology is discussed as if it were neutral or the net effect was positive. And within the peculiar construction of technology and politics in the Valley, very often the state is posited as the enemy, as the thing that is, if not corrupt, then certainly inefficient. And that's where the technologists will step in, and they will solve problems that politicians have been unable to solve, or even, and all you have to do is pick up any edition of Wired magazine, which is kind of like the Bible for people in the Valley in a way, and you will get the opinions expressed that the kinds of problems that human beings are faced with now, like climate change, for example, are too complicated for any human being, or any group of human beings, to properly solve. So that's why we need to build amazing supercomputers and collect a lot of data, so that we can then sort of minimize the risks going forward to alter our human interactions and our behavior. So things like that are motivated by a very strong desire to do good in the world. But nonetheless, I'm rather suspicious of them, because I think that companies that are as powerful as they are, collecting as much information as they do, designing environments in which a good many of us live now for a good portion of our lives, wield huge power. And it's not that it isn't necessarily unaccountable, but it is incredibly influential. And these companies tend to move at a rapid pace, altering the way that they offer services. And very often we just kind of go with the flow. And I think that's the thing that I find alarming. I'm not really sure there is a call to arms here. I'm not sure who would hear me if I said that anyway. With respect to your last point about disenchantment and enchantment, that's really lovely. I really like that you brought sort of Weber in there, because you're right. He's the person that talks about the disenchantment of the world. And it comes about because you banish mystery. Let's just imagine for the moment that what we have with Silicon Valley is the end result of enlightenment thinking, of kind of hyper-rationality. Maybe it's disenchantment squared, it's gone completely mad. I think the fact is that most of us use products and services that are mysterious to us now, as magic was in the medieval period. We really, most of us have no idea how these things work. We're perfectly happy to use them. We get very frustrated when they don't work properly. We're not against kind of knocking them or throwing them away. All right, but I think there's a great deal of magic or magical thinking involved or surrounding these products, and an awful lot of belief, and it's the belief thing that really interests me. The belief of the people at the head of these companies going forward and changing the world, and the beliefs of the rest of us as we use these products and services. That is what I find fascinating.
Thank you. Thanks. Well, let's open this up and start taking a few questions from the floor. Okay, Richard?
I wasn't quite clear what you meant by technology. I mean, because when I think of technology, I immediately think of military technology. Mm. And, I mean, the armed forces and the military, especially in America, have been major drivers of technological change in order to serve their own interests. And I think you need some kind of distinction here, really. But you're talking about civil technology in a way, but of course it flows into military, and I mean the boundaries are really unclear. And when you think of Hollywood's projections of the nightmare dystopian vision of the machines taking over and escaping human control, as in a Terminator or many movies going way back, of course it's the outcome is the military outcome, as the machines start killing human beings. So I think that's a dimension that where you need to sort of draw some boundaries, basically.
Okay, I think you're right, I accept that. It is very difficult to delineate between civil and military because these things do blend so often. The interesting thing about the early days of computer technology in the Valley, though, is that it was many people in cybernetics, for example, that, you know, kind of, who've worked in the military during the Second World War on various projects, who had become very disillusioned, and then advanced the doctrine that computers could be used for good, provided, of course, that that happened in the civilian context, not in the military context, and individuals were empowered as a result. So that was, I think, the reaction that I identified in the literature from that period. So that's the kind of breaking point for me. It doesn't mean, of course, that there isn't continual blending. There is, but...
If you think of drones, for example, I mean, drones, the more drones are used to kill people than are used to deliver pizza, I guess.
Sure, and yeah, given that Amazon's probably publicity stunt to try and get pizzas delivered to, you know, your backyard, it's like, well, all right, I know a lot of people very disappointed when that didn't happen. But the drones thing is actually kind of interesting, and again, we could look at it another way. We could look to children's toys. 2 years ago, I think the leading children's toy in the United States was a little portable drone that you could purchase for about $50 and operate on a cell phone. 2 years prior to that, the cheapest one you could buy was on Amazon, a parent drone, for about $50. So it's coming down and down and down the price, and the civilian drone market is probably going to be the next big market, or one of them. So, yeah, it's a good one.
Two points, you know, a question and a point, but I hope I can link them together, because they're both about question of re-enchantment and something you said at the end about enlightenment, think different talk about enlightenment thinking.
Yes.
I've got an idea of where it comes from, which is the romantic movement and the response to the Industrial Revolution, and you get Wordsworth, I think it said, who wanted to be a pagan, suckled in a creamed out war. And there's something pagan about wanting to relate to these sort of animatronic objects. Instead of one single overarching deity, you have various different systems which can relate. But I was also interested in what you mentioned just now about magical thinking.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering if the re-enchantment point is where conspiracy gets snuck in. Because as Arthur C. Clarke said, any sufficiently advanced technology is indistinguishable from magic, and magic is wondrous and exciting, but it's also by its nature sinister, because it can you don't know what it's going to do to you. I'm also reminded of a comment by Sir David Owen, a Home Office civil servant, in a report about databases or future database or using deep knowledge to provide services to citizens automatically via the net. He said that the public doesn't see the process, so won't be worried about the state knowing all these things and being able to, because they don't know what's going on. But I wonder if the conspiracy element comes in when people start wondering what exactly is going on in there.
They're great thoughts. I really like what you say about the Romantic movement and Wordsworth. Yeah, as I was writing this and I was focusing on Zen because of the California kind of Japanese sort of connection, it occurred to me that probably William Blake would probably have a few things to say about this as well. So thank you for that. I'll have to just think more about it. With respect to kind of sneaking conspiracy back in through the re-enchantment phase, yes, perhaps. I think I'm at that point, with respect to this paper and the broader project of which it forms a part, I'm at that point where I'm still watching kind of Jibo in shock, trying to work out how I actually feel about this. Somebody said this recently of their first journey in Google's autonomous driving car. So when nobody's driving it, but just the software's taking over. They said that they were in the car for about 15 minutes, and for the first 5 minutes, they're absolutely terrified. And the next 5 minutes, it was thrilling. And in the next 5 minutes, they're bored. So the arc was pretty quick, kind of the change in human response. I kind of think that, particularly with these very friendly sort of robots that we'll probably be inviting into our home, we'll go through a similar process. And robots like this, with their surveillance capabilities and their fantastic services that they offer, are likely to be embraced without too much thinking. And I find that rather disturbing and alarming. That probably makes me a bit 19th century, in a sense, because I kind of still like the idea of being left alone and having my own privacy and so on and so forth. But yes, I think I'm still in shock, so I can't really fully answer your question. Very good points, though. Thank you. Yeah. Appreciate it.
I've got a question here.
Yeah, my background is not at all in political science. I'm a technologist, with a background in the free software movement.
Yeah.
I just want to say your analysis is very convincing to me, and I really see a lot of what you're saying. On the question of power relations, I think a lot of people actually don't quite realise what power relations, how those are playing out. You talked a lot about privacy and surveillance, but if you think about things like the Google search bubble and the Facebook filtered feed, that's not a one-way street, and there's a lot of very quite subtle control being exerted there, which is nevertheless very powerful, and users are not, I would say, generally aware of.
No, thank you. No, you're absolutely right. That's a very good point.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Very good. Yeah.
I was one of the things I took away from your talk was the distinction between the ideologies expressed about technology and the actual material or social affordances of different kinds of technologies. And the question that I have is, with both of those dimensions, are there categories or archetypes of technological affordances that resonate more with these concerns, if they're similar in the concerns ideologically about what technologies are and should do and can do, versus what they actually end up doing? And also what you think of the idea of scale and complexity when we're talking so broadly about technologies. And the reason I ask about scale and complexity is, I think if I imagine myself in the 1850s watching my state, let's say in the United States, doing a census of the population, that's a technological apparatus that would be concerning at that period and in that context. And but now it's absolutely fine to, you know, participate in a census to provide demographic data that might be beneficial to me to know what the metrics of my community and state and economy are. Mm-hmm. In that same parallel perspective, I wonder if 50 years from now, the idea that every minute as I sit here that I'm transmitting to Google my location and my gender and my age and my movements will become less of a serious concern because I'll be able to grasp the complexity and manage the risk and expectations. And perhaps in the next 50 years, we will have better accountability of the complex background technocratic processes and decisions that take place.
Yes, well, that's the question, I suppose, isn't it? That one right there at the end. Will we have a better understanding? Will we have better accountability practices and so on and so forth? And I think you're right, 50 years from now, I think there's a good chance that talks like this will be seen as utterly archaic, completely ridiculous, and not worth the data storage where they're stored somewhere. I think that may be probably true, and that's because of all the things and many more besides, some of which I talked about in the talk, changing conceptions of self and society. Interestingly, you should mention the census, though, because I think it was a punch card machine that initiated the census, and the punch card machine has got a very interesting sort of history and trajectory. It's a prototype for some of the early computers.
And it intersects with the Holocaust, in fact.
Well, it does do that as well, yes, that's right. I wasn't thinking that out. Technology can, of course, be used for good ends or bad ends. I don't necessarily think that means the tech is neutral. In the design of the punch card, in the way that people were encoded quite specifically into those punch cards, there's all kinds of politics at work. So I think... if I'm trying to do anything, it's to demystify the technology a little bit. And you're right in that most people, perhaps myself included, won't be conscious of, in quotes, the politics that goes on within the algorithm, the search algorithm, what it leaves out, what it includes. Somebody's made that decision somewhere. That's a human, subjective judgment that is then encoded. But of course, you just see the web screen, and you're in a hurry, so you just take what you're given as something that's really wonderful. And thank goodness for Google. It's a great question.
Here, and then we'll come to you.
Sorry, it took me a moment to get started. Thanks for both a really interesting talk and a really interesting response. Very thought-provoking. And I have two questions. The first is, I found your argument quite interesting and sort of compelling, but I'm wondering how subversion and resistance fit into this argument. I'm thinking in particular about sort of the conspiracy theorists, so people who are sort of trying to unmask these things and the changing discourses around them, and really, like, for example, Snowden as traitor. Now it's become Snowden as hero, and sort of the politics around that. That was the first one. And the second one is the social robotics thing is totally frightening, and that little robot.
Give it time.
I know. But what I'm wondering about with that is, I just want to hear from you what you think about the limits about that are. From my view, there are certain tasks that are fundamentally and inescapably human because they involve subjective judgment, for example, or emotion. And the thing is that if one day our robots are endowed with those features, and this is where I'm going to sound very sci-fi, this means that actually they will no longer do the job that we require of them, which is servitude.
Oh, so they become our masters.
So the very thing that the very limit that I can imagine is one that if we pass, we kind of lose control of the robot.
Yes. Well, of course, it's precisely that concern that was aired famously by Professor Hawking at this university. I think Elon Musk, who's the head of Tesla, blogged about it briefly and suggested something similar. And it's the idea that AI pretty soon will become so advanced that it's not that it won't need us, but it will develop independently of us. People who have responded to that say things like, well, these are philosophical concerns, but the AI isn't there yet. It might be there in 5 or 10 years. But anyway, there's no real need to get worried about that just now. And besides, you're designing the AI so you can install some safeguards. Of course, you could have good AI and evil AI. That's possible. But nonetheless, you can sort of design that out as much as possible. So we'll wait and see, because that's kind of an ongoing conversation. The sad thing about that conversation is, you know, and this is kind of why I tried to blend technology and conspiracy together in the first place, is that very often the people making these really good points talk past one another. It's like the engineers tend, not always, excellent engineers are very broad-minded, but a great many engineers tend not to sweat the fuzzy stuff. You know, they see human problems as offering, you know, or maybe susceptible to a technological or technical analysis and solution. And there's something very empowering about that. because if you can reduce the complexity and fuzziness of human things to a quantifiable or in a quantifiable way, then you can exercise some kind of mastery over it with good math and you know, powerful processes. I guess the question for me is, if, as seems likely, our digital identities, certainly for the generation that's coming through, become equally, if not more important, to our offline identities, then how is that going to affect all kinds of things that we currently do, like vote, like go to school? I mean, think about education as an institution and how that has been identified as a prime site for innovation, technological or otherwise. Let's take it online, let's do all kinds of assessment, let's have this assessment be done in real time so it can be fed back, so we can alter the policy, so we can really educate our children more. Education is an extraordinary site of activity, and I teach in education, I've been part of education for a long time, and it's clear to me that there's, just a personal point of view, there's no real clue as to what it's for. It used to be to create adults. I think that's kind of the origin of the word, going into adulthood. But because adulthood is one of those fuzzy terms that's also very politically loaded, you know, one person's adult may not be another's. How dare you define adult this way? Surely, someone said. It seems like sometimes we're flying blind. So that's kind of interesting. As to whether or not robots will become our masters and overlords, people in the tech sector tend to make jokes about that. There's a show in the US called Jeopardy. I don't know if you've ever heard of Jeopardy. Well, Jeopardy famously included on a special show a computer called Watson. It was an IBM supercomputer, and Watson learned how to play Jeopardy better than any other Jeopardy opponent ever. So he was up against two grandmasters and completely wiped the floor with them. And during the final scene, the final question, one of the opponents wrote down his answer to this obscure question that, of course, Watson got straight away, because genius. And he actually wrote, you know, all hail to our new computer overlords. I kind of placed that there, because he realized that his time as a Jeopardy kind of opponent was up. So there we go.
Just as a brief aside on your point, we had a talk the other week about which kinds of jobs robots will be taking over in the future, and apparently one of the surprising things I heard about this was that robots are surprisingly good at being therapists, and they're being used increasingly in the military in that therapeutic role, but that they're terrible at folding laundry.
Yeah.
So there's still going to be something left for us to do in the future.
Exactly. Cut hair, they're not very good hairdressers.
Yeah. So we have a question at the back here.
I wanted to raise a point about Weber. Yeah. You talk about disenchantment. There's another thing that he raises, his concept of imperative coordination. And that's the basis for his concern with the spread of bureaucracy and its transformation of what he calls the iron cage.
Yeah.
By, in fact, the disciplining of behavior. And what he talks about is something that begins in the 18th century with, in fact, military technology.
Mm.
And how, in fact, the standing armies of that period had to be retrained into the most disciplined forms of behavior so that the technology could be used effectively on the battlefield. These ideas get transferred over into civil bureaucracies in the 19th century. They also get transferred over into industrial processes. It's interesting that after the Napoleonic Wars, a lot of demobilized non-commissioned officers got hired into the factories of Manchester in order to, in fact, control and discipline the workforce. So that's an interesting aspect of it. But what it means is also this. Charles Babbage, before he became, if you will, the inventor of the logic of the computational machine, was, in fact, an expert on industrial processes. We would call him today a kind of management consultant, not a political economist.
Yeah.
He took the logic of industrial production as he saw it in Europe, encapsulated it into something called the Babbage Principle. The Babbage Principle provided the basis for his understanding of the calculating engine and what it would mean to write a logarithm as an effective procedure in a successive of simple steps. He builds that into his effort to build his calculating engine. The same logic, of course, comes into the 20th century computer. But the other thing is, in terms of the disciplining of labor, that logic goes into the development of the industrial assembly line. And the interesting accounts of the introduction of the assembly line in Ford's plant in 1914 is, first, they offered twice the average industrial wage. They were paying $25 a week. The workers who came in, a large proportion of them were so infuriated by the work discipline, by the line itself, that's what set the pace of work, that they had numerous instances of people simply dropping their tools in the middle of a shift and walking away, not even collecting their day's wage. So this is the politics of it, if you will, that's built into computational machinery. It's about disciplining of behavior.
That's great. Thank you. That's wonderful. I didn't talk about that anywhere near as much in my talk as I would have liked, but your points are very well taken. Thank you so much. It's excellent. Thank you.
Yeah.
Look, thanks very much for that. Going back to tension between the Ruskinite sort of Wordsworth vision of our future, that could be all lovely and quite rural and rustic. The opportunity to wander down that path has often been there and been enjoyed by the utopian, the people who went for the utopian communities. Mm-hmm. But nevertheless, as a society as a whole, we've gone down the path of wanting more advanced technological goods, toys, and somehow or another the concept that there might be a butler, even if it just looks and talks to us, is incredibly exciting. The Google car, certainly news stories about those, about advanced technology as the panacea. Everyone loves them. Do you see that it is inevitable that that is the path that we will go? We will find that the compromises in terms of the amount of information that people are acquiring from us, we're really going to be prepared to give them information as long as they don't appear to be coercing us to do something, and we're just going to go that way anyway.
Right, so I'm not going to tell you what I think about, but I will tell you about a very interesting poll that I read recently that was conducted by Ofcom. So I think they only polled something like 2,000 individuals. And almost 70% of the individuals polled, I think it was a cross-section of the British public, said that they would be perfectly happy giving away their personal information online. But they'd be much less happy about giving away credit card information. But personal information, which can include all sorts of things, name, gender, date of birth, address even, maybe, yeah, that's okay. That's fine. I think there's been a shift. Time magazine in the States, rather beautifully and obviously very simplistically, made a distinction a few years ago when on the front cover, their person of the year that they normally have, they just had a computer screen. And the article accompanying that suggested that a seismic shift had occurred in American society, and we were facing a kind of two cultures paradigm. So not C.P. Snow's two cultures, but a different kind. There was the culture of the book, and there was the culture of the screen. And those people that grew up before the internet, well, you're book people. Because that's pretty much how you learn how to do stuff, and you like books, and you're old-fashioned, and God bless you. All right, and everybody else, all right, is going to be growing up in a world where that is going to be the way that you get most of your information. And there's all sorts of really interesting psychological evidence that suggests that young people now read differently. They have a hard time sitting still. My favorite example recently that I read from the BBC was of a group of young children in Northern Ireland, and their teacher, I think, had sent in this report to the BBC website, because the kids have a hard time sitting still. They're about 3 or 4 years of age, and they don't play the building blocks too well anymore. They don't really kind of understand what the point is. And when these kids were taken for a little walk, and they were in front of a glass window in a shop, in a store, all the kids did this. Trying to scroll. They didn't work for them. They're getting very frustrated. It wasn't scrolling. Different kinds of individuals, different expectations, different understandings of the world. So I've no doubt, in answer to your question, I was being a little bit facetious, I've no doubt that people will think differently about concepts like privacy and a host of other things, including their relationships to machinery, to one another, and to their governments.
So, so we've got a question at the back.
I just wondered whether one of the problems is that technology takes us further away from ourselves, from reflection and questioning, and that's perhaps its danger, that the technology can be used for good things or bad things, but that it takes us away from ourselves. And you're going to be worried about that if you have a notion of the individual which has got is problematic. Once that goes and we're into this, we're always connected, we're always with others, then technology makes sense as encouraging us down that path away from ourselves. And perhaps why privacy then is, you know, comes into that equation, because what we do with ourselves, and perhaps we can be reflective if we're in private. So is that something that you perhaps resonate with?
Yeah. Yes, is the short answer, but I think ourselves are the things that are being changed, and we're thinking about ourselves in a different way. That said, this technology is all a human creation. Somebody's creating it, somebody's idea. They design it with a particular end in mind. It's not inevitable that we're going to end up as one particular society or another. Hopefully the political process can step up and step in and have something to say about this. But I think that probably needs to be said a good deal more. And I've raised some of the issues in this talk that hopefully speak to that and your issue. We need to start thinking about this technology in a different kind of way. We need to rehumanize it. Somebody somewhere is coding this stuff. Somebody somewhere is designing this beautiful stuff in a particular way. And it's very easy to get entranced and to forget about all of those people behind the curtain.
Well, that seems an appropriate point to draw these events to a close. If you've been here before, you'll know that there are some glasses of wine waiting for us just outside, so you can carry on the conversation out there. But it just leaves me to thank Lawrence Quill for the wonderful talk.